Good afternoon, everybody. Today I will show nasal polyposis due to allergy, bilateral nasal block. 45 years of age, adult, chronic nasal obstruction, present with chronic nasal obstruction, CT scan done, nasal endoscopy done in the huge poly. I will show the simplified nasal polyposis surgery or functional endoscopic sinus surgery. How a beginner will start the surgery is very simplified with less complication. I'm Dr. Tushar Kanti Ghosh. I'm the director of Ghosh ENT Hospital, the super specialty ENT hospital. Now the 46 years of age, bilateral nasal obstruction of for 8 months, treated with intranasal corticosteroid with anti-allergic long-term basis. No benefit, nasal endoscopy done, CT scan of the nose and paranasal sinus done. Bilateral nasal polyposis involving all sinus cavity, nasal cavity and nasal cavity. Now I'll show the surgery. Now, this is the polyp. Just before starting the surgery, definitely you should pack with gauze, Meroshell or cotton with adrenaline, xylocaine, to delineate the structure and to reduce the bleeding. Some surgeons prefer the injection with adrenaline. Some surgeons don't prefer. They're preferring the injection in the axillary region. Injection is very important. After that, just wait for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and then you should start the surgery. Now, microdebrider, I'm reducing the bulk of the polyp. After delineating the anatomy, this is very important. You see, I'm all time looking the uncinate and here the medially the middle turbinate. So laterally there, I am looking the uncinate and medially the middle turbinate. This is the most important zone. I am working through this part. Here, this is the axilla. Look here, this is the uncinate. So all time, I am carefully first delineate the polyp and normal structure, then I am doing the surgery. Now slowly, I am doing and reducing the polyp. Now to open the maxillary antrum, MMA, with backbiting forceps, two cut, three cut, I am in the zone of horizontal and vertical part. Just with ball probe, I am opening the maxillary antral meatus. And when I am confirmed, then with help of microdebrider, I am doing the work to wide the maxillary antral. Now, we are looking the maxillary antrum. After confirmation, I am doing the upper part of the uncinectomy. Clearly, and just extreme upper part I am preserving. When I will do the frontal sinus surgery, then I will do that part. Otherwise, all part of the uncinect carefully remove to see the properly bulla ethmoidal. So here medially, middle turbinate, laterally, orbit and posteriorly the bulla ethmoidal. Now slowly I am debulk the polyp and all structure also will be delineated. When MMA done properly, an antrum clearly seen, then I will do with the Shakar cum elevator, I'm doing the bulla ethmoidal opening or anteroethmoidectomy, not with the debrider, because the debrider is a sharp instrument. Sometimes by mistake, we injure the important structure. So with the Sakarkam elevator, I am delineating the laterally lamina papyracea, medially the middle turbinate. Now the ground lamella exposed. When I am sure I am reaching the ground lamella, then I stop doing here to do the work and confirm. When I'm confirmed, then loose tissue, loose polyvalve removed. When I'm confirmed the ground lamella thin, then I will go the sphenoid region, because the here is the less chance of injury of the any important structure. This way, look here, medially the septum, laterally the middle turbinate and superior turbinate also. Just identify the superior turbinate. Here the just I'm removing the some part of the polyp and identify the here identifying the superior turbinate. Just lateral to the septum and just look here the superior turbinate. So medial to the superior turbinate and lateral to the septum, you will see the sphenoidal ostium. So confirm the sphenoid ostium from here to prevent any injury to the deep structure, important structure. So here the sphenoid ostium, now sphenoid opening clear. Now I am sure this is the sphenoid. So if I complete the sphenoid opening part, so this is the extreme deep part of the sinus cavity. So the skull base. Now after that, I will connect inframedial. So I will go the sphenoid. So first confirmation through the superior turbinate and septum. Then I am going the inframedially from the osteoethmoid. So this will connect. Will connect the sphenoid. So after that, I will complete the osteoethmoidectomy and antiethmoidectomy each way. So first, confirm the sphenoid and complete the osteoethmoidectomy. Otherwise, you may injure the optic nerve laterally, medially, also the important structure of the sphenoid area. Deep the sphenoid, there is a lot of important structure is there. So there is a chance of injury of the carotid, optic nerve anyway, skull base. So first you confirm the sphenoid and you just look here. From the inframedially, I am looking the cotton of the sphenoid. So I am sure it is the sphenoid opening. After when I am sure the sphenoid opening completed, then I will complete the osteoethmoidectomy up to the skull base, posteriorly up to the skull base and laterally lamina papyracea. It's very important at this point. Here, when with 0 degree, when I am sure up to posteriorethmoidectomy done, laterally lamina papyracea seen, then I just complete the inferior part of the superior turbinate. I have removed it. Then I change the endoscope. I will do the 0 degree endoscope, the frontal. I change the endoscope to the 70 degree after this area completion. Now the sphenoid, clearly sphenoid, you will see. This is the lamina papyracea. There is no chance of injury at all, because this is the, now the, I am taken the sphenoid, 70 degree endoscope. Just completion, sphenoid opening, posteriorethmoid lamina. Then I will change the, this is the 70 degree. I am changing the 7 AD. I am looking the antrum, anterior. Now here the axillary part, I am doing work with the 70 degree. This is my 70 degree endoscope. 70 degree is fantastic, fascinating instrument, because with 70 degree you are too much confident, because the you are working from up down, above down. You are working from above. Look here, you are working from the above down. Slowly, slowly, you are removing the cell like onion. You just removing the cell like onion, and when you are sure that you are in safe zone, you are working with a microdebrider. Look here, axillary part and upper part of the uncinate. I am already told the upper part of the uncinate I will preserve up to finish of my frontal sinus surgery. Look here. I am slowly, slowly, I am completing the frontoidmoid recess, and also I will open. Look here. This is the look here. Now with GQ net, I am removing the JQ rate. Now opening the frontal agar with JQ rate, removing the agar with a cell, and sometimes if possible with the frontal beak also remove with the. Now the JQ rate, I've removed the agar nasal cell. So from the now frontal sinus, when frontal sinus is opening is there, just I am down from above downwards, automatically I'll see the ethmoidal artery. Look here, here lamina papyracea clearly seen. Automatically you will see the ethmoidal artery. Look here clearly. Now this is the anterior artery. It's very safe. Look here. There's the frontal sinus. And you go down. Automatically you will see the anterior artery. So it's very clearly seen the anterior artery. You just go down and then sphenoid. Just before the sphenoid opening, you will see the posterior artery also. Now with the JQ rate, I open more some part of the cell and some part of the soft tissue to clearance frontal sinus opening clearly. Look here, automatically you will see the frontal sinus. Main target is the preservation of the mucosal epithelium, not unnecessary trauma of the frontal sinus. This is the frontal sinus. Also, you will see a glow if you look from outside. Automatically, water, I am giving the water. Frontal beak is there with carison punch. You may punch the upper part, carison punch. Sometimes not required. Look here, the frontal sinus. Now, the frontal sinus anatomy boundary. Medially, the medial turbinate. Laterally, the lamina papyracea. Inferiorly, the anterior artery above the frontal beak. Very simple frontal opening. Now, clearly frontal sinus. The medially, the laterally, inferiorly. All boundaries, the clear boundary. The lamina, this is the lamina, frontal beak is the anterior artery, the middle turbinate. So just down, you just go down, automatically you will see the posterior adrenal artery. You move down, then you see the posterior adrenal artery. I'll show the clearance of the maxillary antrum. Sometimes it's very difficult to clear the maxillary antrum with this instrument. This is the sphenoid opening, clearly seen. Now, see the sphenoid, clearly seen the sphenoid. Now, with the 120-degree rotating forceps, this is the posterior rotating forceps, I will clear the whole structure. Look here, anterior artery, this is the posterior artery, the base, skull base, clearly seen skull base. Clearly seen skull base. Now, 70 degree. Same the opposite side also. Same. Just like onion, I am removing the agar nasi step by step. Nasal cell. Automatically, I will see the frontal. But with 70 degrees, very much. I am very much confident because the all structure will be in our control. Our control. I am doing the axillary work with the micro debrider. No tension because the here not interested. I go more medially, there is a chance of sphenoidea. More medially, there is a chance of C7. More laterally, there is a chance of lamina papyrusica injury and optic orbit injury. So here you will see the now you will see the frontal sinus how will open with JQ red. JQ red. So. With the decurate, just I am removing part of the organic cell, automatically you will see the frontal sinus. Look here. I am not more, not towards direction. So look here, the direction, not medially, not laterally, straight decision, straight direction. So, frontal sinus. Sinus opening. Look here, the front sinus opening. Okay. Just now enlarging the front of sinus with the micro debrider. Look here. And if you see the glow, the frontal glow will be seen properly. Properly. So now, all tissue removed. And so, look here. All tissue removed. Skull base seen same way. Yes. I am now interesting part is the anterior part of the maxillary antrum and laterally. It's very difficult. Look here. There is a two difficult portion, anterior and lateral part. I have a one instrument, 120-degree rotating forceps. I'm using this to remove the polyp from that part. Otherwise, 120 degree rotating micro debrider to remove the polyp. Sometimes it's not possible with micro debrider also. So that time you need 120 degree rotating forceps. Clearly. All clear and sometimes to prevent, this is the most important part of the surgery, stabilize the middle terminate. Some surgeon cut the lower part of the middle terminate, sometimes I don't follow this part. Sometimes stitching with the middle terminate also I follow this sometimes if I think this the middle terminate is stable, I put the gel foam to protect the my middle terminate in stable condition. Very vulgarized also I am doing time to time vulcanization to maintain the drill turbine stabilization. So all will be the part of stabilization. So I think it is the good complete surgery. Then place the mirror shell. Then now I'll show only just only frontal sinus opening. How will preserve the epithelia? Because sometimes during frontal sinus surgery, you just if you remove and if you pull, so all epithelium of the frontal sinus will be removed. So there is a chance of frontal stenosis. So to avoid this, you all time just you maintain this way to protect the epithelium here. This is the frontal sinus epithelium. If you remove all, there is a chance of stenosis in future. So just protect it, new epithelium, just cut it. And with the microdebridement, just pulping, no direct trauma to the frontal sinus epithelium. Now I'll show the follow-up after surgery. Follow-up is very important. If good follow-up after 7 days and after 14 days, 1 month also, should check with endoscope. And I will show if check after 1 month endoscope, if you do good surgery, then this type of follow-up. So look here is the outdoor. So single chip camera, 3-chip camera, not Scorch HD camera. So picture quality not so good like OT. Their HD ICE camera is there. Here HD camera, but cheap camera. Full model HD camera. Look here, all sinus cavity is the good opening, fantastic. After surgery, if you see this type of cavity after operation, you will be happy. Yes. Sometimes some crust will be there. You just clean it by endoscopy. Look here. Sometimes you will see some area, some crust after 1 month also. Just clean it and you will see the good entram, good frontal sinus cavity, good sphenoid and nasopharynx also, straight septum. So look here, middle turbine is stable. There is a slight bit of polyp is there. Spray required, spray, rescue, steroid rescue, sphenoid, all draining is the complete. Fantastic drain, you'll be happy and patient will be happy. There is a chance of recurrence is definitely less, but you should give good intranasal corticosteroids. It is long term process. Just give and you will see the this type of cavity. Okay, and good sphenoid cavity. So thank you. Thank you. This is the surgery and doing the regularly this way, and my junior also doing this way. So they is very safe technique. I think this is the safe technique to do for junior also to prevent unnecessary complications. This is the safe technique. I'm following this technique. Acha they bolina eta eta first part hoye gelo polyp. Hello
hello sir, ha bolun
eta ekhon ektu stop koru apatoto. Hello.
কথাবার্তা
তো রেকর্ড এডিট হয়ে যাবে। আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে, মোটামুটি ছবি টবি ভালো এসছে মোটামুটি?
একদম স্যার, ক্লিয়ার ছিল সমস্ত কিছু। By coblation, advantage of the coblation, there is a lot of advantage. Same day discharge without any primary hemorrhage, without any reactionary hemorrhage, and same day discharge. I will show that from admission to discharge, how we are maintaining and how we are doing every day this surgery. Now, if you see before surgery, huge obstruction. See before surgery. Huge obstruction, OSA, totally OSA present. Huge tonsil, huge adenoid. And but last 3 years treated with the intranasal corticosteroid, anti-allergic, antibiotic, repeat antibiotic, not relieved any way. And also some doctor tell there is no chance of doing the tonsil adenoid also. But I have done the surgery. And you look there, relief, and family getting the relief big way. And just after 7 days after surgery, fantastic improvement, no sound, totally comfortable life for child and family also. Before that, they are very scared every day, a lot of time admitted for upper respiratory infection, lower respiratory infection. Saturation fall, now their life totally changed in the tonsil. Today I will show tonsillectomy, adenoidectomy, adenoidectomy with coblation. Lot of advantage with coblation. Totally bloodless, less morbidity, no primary hemorrhage, no reactionary hemorrhage. There is a doubt of secondary hemorrhage, but if you follow the technique, then nearly nil will be the secondary hemorrhage also. Now I will show if huge tonsil adenoidectomy with no means intranasal corticosteroid, anti-allergic, with antibody, lot of time not improved, then you should do the surgery and you will get benefit here before surgery. Huge obstruction, totally OSA patient, lot of time get admission for the upper respiratory tract infection, lower respiratory tract infection, saturation fall down. This is the miserable life. This is the miserable life. Now, just after operation, look at the result. Life totally will be changed. Life change of family also. Definitely child, family also. They are totally relieved. Every day before surgery, they are totally scared. Now I will show the admission and discharge also within 6 hours from admission, how patients doing OT tonsillectomy under the microscope, and how adenoidectomy with done, every step and movement also I will show, and definitely surgery I will show. Now first I am showing the tonsils. Now just before operation, sound, look, sound, nasal obstruction. And adenoid and also tonsil. Look here, the sound, nasal obstructive sound. Now, admission same day. Now, just before OT, in OT table, now, look here, under a microscope, this is the microscope. I am doing under a microscope the position, look the position, supine position, and head end, I am sitting in the head end with a microscope. Now, here, under microscope, I am doing, look here, I will show the tonsillectomy properly. Here from the monitor, I am showing how it will be recorded this way. Is the recording system will be there. Now I am doing this way. Look here, my movement. Now, without any bleeding, I am completing this surgery. Look here. Now, same the left, and in left sided tonsil, I am holding the tonsil with my right hand, and when with my left hand. Look here, left hand. Look here, this way, the left hand. Just from upper pole, I am going to the lower pole. I'll show the surgery first. I'm showing how it will be done. And without any drops of bleeding, this will be complete. After completion of the surgery, you just rub it. If you see that any venous oozing is there, just coagulate it to prevent the secondary hemorrhage. Now, when just complete the tonsil, just suction, there is a lot of secretion. So huge adenoid will be there. Huge adenoid. Look here, I'm putting the wand. I'll show the adenoid also. Separate system. Separate how will adenoid do my position. I'll show. This is the adenoid also, the same patient. No bleeding at all, no bleeding. Fantastic. Now, just upper OT, the OT table, within of 1 minute, is the monitor, just without any bleeding, without any problem, just after 2 hours, patient total normal. I will show the microscopic tonsillectomy with coblation, totally bloodless. How? Look here. I am introducing the one sucker tube, sucker or sucker catheter from through the nasal cavity. When I will do the surgery, there is a lot of water accumulated in the oropharynx. That water, it will suck. So if water accumulated with the oropharynx, then surgery will be problematic. Wand will not work. My vision will be obstructed. So for that purpose, now I am placing one sucker catheter in the oropharynx. Now I will show the surgery, how I am doing the surgery. Look here, right sided tonsil, left sided tonsil. During right sided tonsil, I hold the with left hand. Look here, with tonsil holder, and right handed my coblation wand. From upper pole to lower pole, I'll dissect. Now here, my target is to open the first plane, tonsillar plane. Look here, the blue line is there, blue line. This is the plane, peritonsillar fiber. This is the peritonsillar fiber. The peritonsillar fiber, my left hand, I'm pulling the tonsil, right hand with the coblation wand. I'm slowly, just like pain holding, slowly I'm touching the peritonsil area. not touching towards muscle, not touching the tons lymph tissue, but my wand opening, cutting end will be towards tons lymph tissue, not opposite direction. If wand will be opposite direction, there is a chance of injury of the muscle. So here, slowly, palatoglossus muscle, total boundary, palatoglossus and palatopharyngeus and superior constrictor muscle will be there, but not injuring any muscle. I am removing the properly tonsil lymphoid tissue. Sometimes if problem, just I am changing my grip. Just look here. Slowly, I am just touching the coagulation, and it is very surprisingly, without any drops of blood, I am completing my surgery. Just like magic wand. I'm going to the lower pole now. I'm preferring always from upper pole to lower pole. Now, pillar, intact pillar is very important. If you injure the pillar and if you injure the muscle, there is a chance of pain. There is a chance of also secondary hemorrhage. Now, here the lower pole, I'm just not pulling here. Just pulling, and with the wand, just look here, complete the surgery. Now the right-sided surgery done, and after completion, just check the tonsillar bed. Just tonsillar bed also, check rubbing, any venous oozing is there or not. Now the left side. Left-sided tonsil, same concept, but left-sided tonsil, left-handed, my coagulation wand will be the in my left hand, right-handed tonsil. I am holding the tonsil with my right hand. Now, look here, same concept, I expose first the plane, in only the main concept, opening the plane first. Plane, if you search the plane first, then operation like child's plane. Look here, so totally clear-cut anatomy. Why magnification? Why under microscope? Is all tissue will be clearly identified. Tonsillar tissue, lymphoid tissue in the oropharynx, lateral side. All tissue, all lymphoid tissue will be identified properly. The peritonsillar fiber. And the change of my holding, just very important, because the positioning of the cutting edge is very important. Pull properly, then you will see the exact area of work and complete the surgery. Slowly, here complete. No bleeding at all. And just rub it, if possible, with the wand, you may rub it this way. If any portion, you will see the red, any sorts of blood, oozing, slight bit of oozing, just coagulate it. Look here, checking 2 minutes, 3 minutes, and surgery will be completed within 10 minutes or 5 minutes, sometimes 2 minutes. Surgery, but check within 2 minutes, 3 minutes, you should check and don't look again and again. Complete the surgery, totally checking, no any way, no drops of blood. So I am completing my microscopic tonsillectomy with the coagulation. After that, I will show the adenoid surgery. Adenoid surgery is the most important with the population, because without there is a huge chance of recurrence. I'm getting nowadays huge portion of recurrent adenoid, because the not completion surgery, the residual adenoid was there, and that way again there is a chance of obstruction. If you do endoscopy, then you will see again the adenoid is there. Now, same concept of adenoidectomy from full boundary of the adenoid. Now I will show total boundary of the adenoid, total removal, zero recurrence. You will reach the zero recurrence nearly. If you follow, if you check regularly, sometimes for few months, then there is a zero chance of recurrence. Look here. Now I am reducing the adenoid tissue in bulk. Look here, my movement of the coagulation. Fine. Now, is that laterally fossa rosenmuller upper part, and anteriorly the torus tuberus, and below the passavans ridge. I will complete the total. And superiorly periosteal sheath above the over the body of the sphenoid, and posteriorly, extreme posteriorly, the buccopharyngeal fossa or perimysial sheath. Buccopharyngeal fossa. So you should complete the surgery now through one nasal cavity. I am completing the one-sided adenoid surgery, and is very careful about tick just posterior part of the septum. That part sometimes there is some initial vein is there, slight bit of bleeding there is a chance. Now when I am completing the one-sided adenoid completely, I'll go the opposite side. I'll not try to complete the surgery from the one-sided, from one-sided nasal cavity. Very difficult sometimes. This is the opposite side. Sometimes if DNS is there, I will use the 30 degree 2.7 endoscope. I use the 2.7 periodic endoscope for periodic adenoidectomy. Look here again, same concept from superior pole to. I am starting the from superior pole. You will see the periosteum over the body of the sphenoid. This is the extreme superior boundary of now the fossa rosenmuller area laterally and superiorly, and the anteriorly the torus tuberus, and inferiorly the passavans ridge, and posteriorly the buccopharyngeal. Look the buccopharyngeal fossa. This is the fossa. Not every area I'll remove the all adenoid tissue to show the buccopharyngeal fossa, because if I do this way, after operation there is a chance of neck muscle spasm, pain and headache, Raynaud's syndrome, danger syndrome. So if I see the perimysial seed, complete the periosteum, passavans ridge, and tell the torus tuberus, my surgery will be complete. Then I will complete the surgery, and definitely after surgery, few months into the corticosteroid, the allergic required. Believe me, if you check the endoscope again after 1 month, complete the area without any issue, will happen. There is no chance of it. Thank you so much. Today I will show the otosclerosis epididymis surgery in case of otosclerosis. Now, the 32 years of age, 58.3 decibel hearing loss, and right side at 50 decibel hearing loss. Now I will show the result also after doing surgery. And I prefer all time skitter. And I will show the different technique to prevent the complications. This is the result after surgery, 21.6 decibel. Now the result. Now I will show the surgery of the stapes, and also I will show the follow up also patients after showing the surgery. Now I will show the stapes surgery. How I do it is very simple way. reverse technique. But for good exposure, I prefer the indoor incision always, because the my two hand work. And after tympanometer fluff elevation properly, bone deep, and good exposure required, which still, if possible, if you have a contralateral drill, then it is more comfortable. The contralateral drill, I am elevating in the, I'm removing the outer epicrural and expose the stapes. Now, the good exposure, I think, good is checking the movement. This is a fixed. Now, my main technique is a very Rasagola technique. It's a simplified technique to prevent complex and to get the easy and to get best outcome. How? I am now the washing of the medullary cavity, sucking with water because the some bony dust will be there. Now, complete. Yes. Now the checking the movement. The fix. Now the foot plate. Foot plate. Place gel foam. If any bleeding point is there, I don't allow any drops of bleeding during surgery. Now the measurement before fenestration. Now first, most important, I am doing very beginning the fenestration. When all will be intact, I am doing fenestration. Look here. My left hand tip sucker is there. Any drops of blood here, just suck it. I don't allow any drops of blood in the foot plate, because the, it creates problem. Now, with the perforator, I am doing fenestration over the foot plate. When the registration, when no resistance, means there will be fenestration done. So the fenestration opening, good fenestration, I think. They appreciate the fenestration. And all will be intact at the time. I'm enlarging the fenestration because the, I prefer the 0.7, 0.8 because I'll put the piston 0.6. 2.2 millimeter extra will be there for snugly fitting. Free movement of the piston. Now I place the piston here. Very beginning, that is totally different from any other sacroiliac surgery. I follow this technique to prevent complication. Now I'll put piston, straight piston, and first fenestrator, and then over the incus. Okay. Fixed. Tightly fixed to prevent any conductive loss. When it is fixed, then I will do the posterior fluoroscopy with the skitters. Very interesting. All will be done. First, my principle is the do everything before everything. Do everything means all will be completion of the surgery. Then I will do the posterior fluoroscopy. Do everything before everything. Now I am doing the posterior fluoroscopy. Is the posterior cloretomy with the skewer. It's very much so. Look here, why D? Because the movement of the foot plate, movement of the incus, all will be here less. Already done everything. So here chance of complex is very less. How much foot plate is less? Foot plate dislocation is very, very, very less. Foot plate. Removing during cloretomy is very less. This is the way I am doing Now the just anterior crotomy. So posterior crotomy done. Now I am doing with the crotomy seizure. I am doing that. Look here. Just slightly back. Yes, this is the technique of anterior crotomy. Sorry. Look here. This is the technique of anterior crotomy. This is the technique of anterior crotomy. Okay. Just anterior crotomy. Doing the anterior crotomy. So safely, I confirm the anterior. Look here. Head change. I see the anterior. Clear cut and removing the anterior. Free movement. Look here, this is the anterior. Fighting. So I'll remove the anterior. So, piston placement first, then posterior crotomy, then anterior. It's very simple, say. But this surgery is very difficult, sometimes very complicated. If you do different, look here. This way. So, stepless surgery, simplified stepless surgery. This is the simplified stepless surgery. Stepis, dotomy, stepidotomy simplified. And also the preserve the stepidal tendon. Also. Look here. And if you preserve the stepidal tendon, you will see if you clap. To clap, then you will see the stepidial tendon movement, the reflex. Look here. Look, the stepidial reflex. Stepidial reflex will be there. So why unnecessary? If possible, you are able to preserve the stepidial tendon. Why unnecessary? We'll cut the stepidial tendon. Try to preserve the stepidial tendon. So functional stepidotomy. So it will be the functional stepidotomy. All will be intact. Only posterior crotomy, anterior crotomy remove after doing everything. After doing piston placement, then I will remove the anterior crotomy and posterior crotomy. So there is chance for complex and it's very, very less negligible. So I am following this technique last 15 years and I have done at least 1,500 stepidotomy. I complete very, very less. Believe me, very, very less. Now, I will show, sometimes there is a question. If facial nerve descends, then how will you do this way? I will show this technique also. Which way I will do again? How I will do if facial nerve will be my path? I will overcome it. Hence, very difficult to follow this technique in case of facial nerve dehiscence. But my principle is the same. After good exposure, one case I am showing how will overcome. Good exposure, you will not see any foot plate. So is just abandon or not. Now, I am following my technique, but the reverse way. I am doing cut. First, cut the stepidial tendon. Then, with the skitter, I will do the posterior crotomy. Not I am removing the suprastructure. I am doing the posterior crotomy to delineate the foot plate. Look here, the foot plate is there. So, just after removing the posterior crura and clearing the foot plate. Now, this is the foot plate, again the same technique and measurement. Still, anterior crura is preserved. Look here. Now, I am doing the fenestration of the foot plate with the 0.6 to 0.7. diameter perforator, and after completion of the fenester, I am putting the piston. Then fixation, still anterior crura is preserved. A fixation, okay. Still my anterior crura is just here. Follow Just after piston placement, I am removing the anti-coulomb and suprastructure. Look here. To prevent any complex of the foot plate to movement, to minimize the movement of the my foot plate, so there is a less, very, very rare chance of sensorial loss. Just I am removing the suprastructure. Full movement, and I'm happy. Still, principle is the same. Do everything before everything, but here preservation of the stability is not possible anyway. But surgery is the fantastic and successful.